Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's session. I'm Bhavesh from the Swift Enterprise product management team. And today we'll be taking you through the updates that are part of the recently released 5.6 version. Before we begin, we would like to assure you that the webinar is being recorded and it will be shared with all those who have registered for the session. You can also subscribe to our Digiday YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get an update whenever we upload the webinar recording. We would also love to hear your feedback and clarify any doubts you may have for the feature showcased today. So please type in your questions and feedback in the Q&A box on the right-hand side of your screen anytime during the webinar so that we are able to take those up towards the end of the session. So without further ado, let's get started. So the agenda for today's session is, first we'll look at some of the new capability that we have for our Agile module, wherein it is now going to be easier to classify cards on the execution board, as well as a new widget that is going to help you keep track of the work that is getting spilled over on a sprint-on-sprint basis. After that, we'll quickly go over some of the enhancements that we have done in our ECR framework that will allow you to have emails sent every time there is an error in the configuration being set up for your validations to work or metric calculations to work, as well as also have a quick understanding of how you can now store and retrieve data easily without a whole lot of configuration that you need to do now. Apart from these, we have done a whole lot of usability enhancement across the application. So first up, we'll look at the new features for our execution board. For that, let me switch to the application. So what I have here is that I have opened up the execution board in my Agile project. And as you can see, I have a whole lot of user stories and some bug that I need to keep track of for my ongoing release. Now, while we have a whole lot of functionality available on the execution board, especially on the higher zoom level, wherein you can see certain attribute information upfront. So for example, I'm able to see the module being tagged to any of these cards upfront, as well as if I want to look at the complete value, I can hover over it and look for it. However, if I want to quickly know which are the cards which are belonging to a certain module, one would have to go about using the filter option. And when you do that, you end up losing all the other cards which do not meet the filter criteria. So in order to meet this need of having to highlight certain types of cards or certain cards belonging to a certain category, what we have done is we have introduced a new feature called legend. So this is available through our overflow menu for the execution board. And what it does is it presents you with the same attributes based on which you are able to filter currently, also color code the cards based on those attribute values. So for example, what I could do here is I could go to customer and say that let me highlight all the cards which are belonging to the dental industries. So this is a customer attribute that has been set on the user stories and bugs. And the moment I click apply, what it does, it highlights the cards which are belonging to those category. So all these are the cards which have been reported by the customer or been done for the customer dentally. So even though that attribute is not seen upfront on the card, this color coding is going to help me quickly look for the card on the execution board, irrespective of the amount of cards I have there. In fact, I can go ahead and also make a selection of a color so that I can say that a certain color belongs for dentally, another color for Access Capital, another for RIDA insurance. So all that can be done when you are looking for cards on the execution board. Another way you can use the legends is for card owners. So if you're wanting to look for cards belonging to a specific card owner, you could do that as well. So you could select all and apply so that all the cards on the execution board are shown there. And there are other views where you are also not able to see the profile picture for other zoom levels. So in that case also, it will help you look for that classification if you are wanting to look for specific cards. So in this case, what I could do is can make a color selection saying that show me all the cards for this user and make that selection so that only cards belonging to a certain user are also highlighted without having me to lose context of the other cards belonging to this release. So this definitely is going to help me look for the relevant cards based on my attribute values. And if you are not wanting to use it for any of the attributes, what you could also do is you can go ahead and use it for just color coding the cards as well. So generally you have set up card colors. So you could select that and say apply, and you will see all the cards colored as per the card color. So this is another way you can use the legends if you are wanting to have some colorful cards on the execution board. So that's one of the ways you can visually classify the cards on the execution board without having to filter them. And at a glance, you are able to do that. So moving on to the next feature is we have for the spillover widget. So what we have done here as part of the 5.6 version, you now have a new spillover work widget as part of the Agile analytics that are available in your Agile projects. So what you will see is a new spillover work widget, and you can simply drag and drop it, and it will set up for the recent 12 sprints automatically. What I have done here is I'm looking at the last 10 sprints. Now, what we are looking at here is the amount of work that has been spilled over for each of the sprint. Now, clearly I can see there is a trend which is going up and then down and then slightly stabilizing in 10 and 13. Now, what are the spillover work items that we are considering for the computation of this spillover percentage? Now, depending upon the items that have been tagged to the sprint as part of the sprint scope, and during the sprint, if they have been untagged, those will get counted as the spillover items. So in this case, let me say, if I drill down on the 20%, which has been shown for sprint 1.2, I can see there are about, or rather 30 items which were planned for the sprint, and six of them got removed or untagged from that sprint. So that's why we are seeing a percentage of 20% for your sprint 1.2. So this is going to help you know how much work got removed or descoped from the sprint. While this may not be the only case, there is another scenario wherein the team has started working on that work item and they were not able to finish the work. So in those cases, what the team generally does is they go ahead and create a spillover work item so that the effort and the time spent against the card in the current sprint gets counted for that sprint, as well as a new card gets created for the spillover work. So in those cases also, since the work could not be completed as planned or committed earlier, that item gets considered as spillover. So let's say I look at this 20%. Now, here too, I have about, say, 30, 35 items here. But what you can also see is I have a spillover item as well. So I have created a spillover card for the work which was planned as part of USG 234. And that's why it's getting considered as part of my overall spillover. In fact, not always the team goes ahead and removes certain items from the sprint scope. There are times when they trade items so that some urgent items which need to be taken up on priority get added as part of the sprint scope. So we are also considering those items getting added as part of the sprint and then deriving the overall spillover percentage. So upon drill down, you get a complete visibility of how many items were planned, how many items were removed, how many were created as spillover, and in case the team has also taken up work in place of the cards that got removed, those are also being shown. So you get a complete context of what has happened that led to this percentage of spillover. If you're just wanting to look at the number of items which got spilled over or the amount of estimated points which got spilled over, you can decide to change the aggregation type from work item count to points, and also decide whether you want to see it in terms of percentage or simply the value of the work item count and estimated points. So that's how easy it is for you to now keep track of the spillover that is happening for your Agile teams. Now, spillover, as it may seem, is a negative term, but as we just saw, it needs to be seen in context of why that spillover has happened. Like I said, sometimes the team has taken up work in place of some other work that needed to be taken up on priority. So that's why certain items were considered as spillover, as well as new work got added. And if you are having a trend, let's say somewhere between 5 to 10%, maybe the team is trying to improve its throughput on a sprint on sprint basis. And that's why it's trying to take more work than what its capacity is. And that may be a reason why the spillover is in a certain range. So while we do have a widget that helps you understand the amount of work that is getting spilled over, the drill down does help you give more context, as well as you would like to interact with the team and understand why certain items were getting spilled over. So what we looked at is how you can visually classify cards at a glance on the execution board with the help of the new legends feature, as well as looked at the spillover work widget that is going to show you the amount of work that got untagged or got spilled over from the sprint, as well as drill down to see the overall scope of the sprint, how much work items got added, removed, and spilled over, so that you have a complete understanding of what all happened as part of that sprint. Moving on to our ECR announcements. Now, as part of our ECR framework, the configurators do have power to create whole lot of rules, whole lot of configuration that is going to help derive value for the metrics, the custom metrics that are getting set for all the different kinds of work scope that has been monitored. Now, generally, for them to be able to store that data or retrieve that data, what happens is they go about creating certain hidden fields across eForms so that they are able to fetch that information very easily, as well as store that information very easily. Now, one drawback with this approach is when you are doing this, you are adding to the overall configuration time and effort that goes behind it, as well as since we are retrieving data from a certain field attribute, you are going to make those many DB calls for you to get that data. Now, in place of that, what the configurators can do is make use of the new optional parameters, which are now available as part of the generate item literal. Now, generate item literal generally gets used when you are wanting to compute certain information or derive certain information. And this literal now has a couple of more optional parameters that helps you store the key name as well as the key values, so that you are able to pass it every time the item is getting regenerated. As well as we have given a couple of new setter and getter literals, so that you are able to fetch that data and set that data every time you regenerate that item. So all that is now going to be possible and become much more easier thanks to this new enhancement to the regenerate item literal. Also, if you are doing a whole lot of configuration, there are going to be times when the configuration may end up with failure or an error, and not always that error is going to be seen on the application UI upfront. Now, for those cases, what we have done is we do have already a literal that helps you throw that error. Now, if that error is something that needs to be understood and debugged further by the configurator so that they can avoid it at a future instance, we have provided a couple of more optional parameters, being the email ID as well as whether the content should be sent to a specific email ID, so that every time such an error occurs, that email gets generated and sent to the specified email address. So you could have certain configurations being taken care by certain configurators or configuration teams. In all those areas, you can now start setting up this throw error literal with additional parameters for email ID and sending that notification, so that the team gets the error notification anytime such an error occurs. So they don't have to wait for an end user or some other reason for them to know that an error has occurred and probably needs to be corrected as soon as possible. So error notification for those critical areas can be set up by the configurations team. Also, the notification email is going to contain all the important error details and item details for them to debug this at the end. So that's how it's going to be helpful for the configurators to manage their configuration much more efficiently and effectively with the introduction of these optional parameters for thrower and literal. And apart from these two major updates, what we have also done is for all the ECR data entry columns, there are no longer any special character restrictions whenever you're wanting to enter data for such segments. So you have a free hand just like you had for your eForm field segments. Moving on to the other enhancements that we have done as part of this release. So we have done a whole bunch of usability enhancements for our agile work items. So up until now, whenever you try to close a work item which had any open to-dos against it, what used to happen is that it was prompt the user to go ahead and close the to-dos first and then go try and close the agile work item. So that is used to be obviously an additional step for the end user always. So we have tried to cut short that by having a single confirmation screen for closure of the to-dos whenever you are going to close a agile work item with open to-dos. Also, we have given an option for you to close the original work item whenever you are creating a spillover card. So as we saw, the spillover cards are the ones which get reported as part of the spillover work widget. So if you're wanting to create a spillover card and close the original card for which the spillover work has happened, generally that is the case when you are towards the end of the sprint. So you can make the selection and it will go ahead and close that original card, as well as it will get all the effort logged against its to-do auto-approved so that the effort gets published as actual effort and the to-dos get closed. Next up, what we saw is the new releases and sprints view. It was introduced in our past release, and what we have ensured is that the scope of the release in terms of the work item count and the estimated points is going to be as per the new scope freeze date. So we have ensured that the scope freeze date gets considered for such statistics as part of the release and sprints view. Also, we have cleaned up the UI for our to-do segment so that ID of the to-dos are visible upfront and overall consistency in the naming convention. Along with these, what we have also done is we have introduced a new eForm for our agile projects called ad hoc work. So if you're wanting to keep track of any miscellaneous work that keeps getting added, this is one of the default out of the box eForm that you could use as part of tracking those miscellaneous work items. Also, to keep track of the spillover cards, every time you create a spillover card, what we have done is a couple of new fields on the work item called spillover release and spillover sprint will keep track of the original release and the original sprint from which the card got spilled over. So now you will be able to filter out easily from your eForm listings or advanced filter, which are the cards which got spilled over as part of that release or sprint. On the eForm front, what we have done is selection of drop-down values for your advanced filter has become a whole lot of easier, especially for the attributes which have a whole bunch of values going in hundreds and thousands. So you still would be able to go ahead and make a selection easily with the help of the new search select a way of selection for the drop-down values. Also, on the eForm listing, you will now be able to see the applied advanced filter right on top. So every time you have advanced filter applied, there's a clear indication on top of the eForm listing itself that is going to tell you whether an advanced filter has been applied. In fact, you can go ahead and click on the name of the advanced filter to see the filter criteria as well. On the mobile app front, what we have done as part of this release is you will now be able to export the dashboard widget data in XLS, Word, and PDF format. So just like you were able to export the dashboard widget data on your web application, you can download it onto your mobile from the export option available on the dashboard widget. As well as for your burn down chart and the pyramid chart, you will now be able to drill down by double tapping on the chart to see the drill down of all the work items which are contributing to the overall remaining effort, actual effort. All that information will be available to you on the mobile app dashboard as well. So this information also comes in handy if you're on the go. So with that, we have covered what was released as part of 5.6 version. What we'll do now is open up for question and look if there are any questions that need to be answered or any feedback that you would like to share with us. So I see a question wherein query has been raised that how is the work item getting considered as spillover when it is getting untagged from the sprint, because sprint planning is also going to add and remove work items. So yes, we definitely understand that at the start of the sprint, you will be in a phase wherein you go ahead and add certain work items or maybe even remove certain work items for the sprint based on the available capacity and various other constraints based on which the team agrees to a sprint scope. So what we had done as part of our previous releases is introduced a new field called scope freeze date. Now the scope freeze date helps us understand that now this is the scope that has been frozen and committed by the team for them to be considered as the planned scope. So if you have set up the scope freeze date, we consider the items which are set as the items to the release or the sprint as the planned scope. Or if you haven't set a scope freeze date, what we do is we go by the sprint start date itself as the planned scope. So if you are considering the planning activity, the sprint planning activity as part of the sprint duration itself, we would definitely recommend you to go ahead and start using the scope freeze date so that any work items getting added or removed at the start, they don't get considered as spillover or added scope. Only after the scope freeze date, if there is any item getting added or removed, those items get considered for our spillover work computation. So I see another question with respect to the legend feature, wherein is the legend feature applicable to all the users? So well, the legend feature is something wherein the user would like to see certain cards based on the attribute values. So not always the end user would want to make that change happening for all the team members. So what we have done, just like your filters, just like you filter the cards on the execution board, it only filters the card only for that logged in user. You are going to see the impact of the legend feature as well, only to yourself. And with respect to, so one question I see is, how does the drill down work for the dashboard widget on mobile? So yes, so this is something which we have implemented as part of our previous version. So if you're looking at the table data, you simply need to tap on the number. But if you're looking at a chart, what you would need to do is double tap on the chart to see the drill down information. The reason why we have done that is a single tap generally shows you the chart information or the chart legend. So that's why you just need to do a double tap on the chart to see the drill down details. Hi Jayashree, you can go ahead and ask your question as well.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible now.
Yeah, like the closing of to-dos which you were referring, right? So is this available only for spillover stories or in general for all stories?
Right, so it is available for all the stories. So there are two changes that that we have made. If you're trying to close an agile work item with open to-dos from your regular eForm view, details view as well, so you can go ahead and close it and it will simply ask for a confirmation saying that should we go ahead and close the open to-dos as well. And if you say yes, it will close the open to-dos as well as the work item.
No, that option is available when we are trying to close the story itself, is it?
Yes, it is available when you are trying to close a story, and it is and whenever you are creating a spillover card, that option is also available for you to do that. So just one second for that. So this is the screen that comes up whenever you are creating a spillover card. So when you are on the execution board, you can okay, let me just open up the execution board. I think it will be easier to understand that way. So let's say the team member has lock time on this card, and what you can do is go on the overflow menu of that card and say add spillover card, and you will have an option here to close the user story when you are creating the spillover card. Now this is something which may not be applicable always, so that's why we have given it as an option whenever you want to close the original card while creating the spillover card. And the
Okay, what
other,
if we don't have any spillover?
if you don't
So
have any spillover, I mean, you can go ahead and complete it, and you can, I mean, if you can simply untag it from the sprint. So that is the other way through which you can remove it from the sprint scope. All right.
Thanks, Bhavesh.
Another question I see here is, if my organization is not going to be using the bug eform or ad hoc work eform, will it affect the agile execution? Basically, are they all going to be optional? Yes, definitely bug eform and ad hoc work eform are optional eforms. The reason why we have introduced those work items as product ship items is we felt that these are the things which usually get tracked by agile teams. So in order to reduce the overall configuration effort that goes behind setting up the new eforms, we have provided as product ship. Also, another advantage that you get with bug eform is that instead of relying on the traditional defect eform that we have, which works on the workflow, with the bug eform, you will be able to plan it, track it on the execution board. So that is another benefit that you would get as part of the bug eform, while the old defect eform works well in the traditional context wherein it cannot be seen on the execution board or planned for. So I see Jayashree asking, is this option available via web service as well? So I'm not able to recall that right now. So probably we'll get back to you on that one. Okay, so looks like we have answered all the questions that we had. If in case you still have any questions regarding the features we demonstrated today or any other features that you may have, do feel free to contact us, contact your support Spock for more details, and we'll surely get back to you on that. So, that's all we had for the session today. Thank you for your time. Have a nice day.